Welcome back. This is the Bill Kelly Show on 900 CHML. You're watching on Cable 14. Local award-winning professor is out with a brand new book. It's called Information Bombardment, Rising Above the Digital Onslaught. I'll give you the website address in just a couple of seconds. You know him, you love him, and we're pleased to have him back here. Nick Bontis, professor of the DeGroote School of Business at McMaster University. Good to see you today.
Great to see you on this fine snowy day.
Yeah, welcome back to winter. I guess we both slept through spring and summer. How was it for you?
Well, I can't believe that we're, you know, Easter's around the corner and here we're dealing with snow. You know, normally Easter's set aside for that weekend where you start cleaning out the front yard and the backyard, but I guess we're going to have to shovel first.
Yeah, I smartly didn't put the snowplow away this year, so it's still kicking in the garage there, so we'll see what we can do about this. I want to talk about a whole bunch of stuff. We're even going to spend a few minutes talking about the upcoming economic summit, because you're going to be very much involved in that, too. But talk to me about the book.
Sure.
You had the launch last week. It went very well.
That's right. We had the launch Thursday night at Carmen's. It went very well. About 190 people showed up. Hamilton's not known for having large book launch events, but we did a little bit of an unorthodox approach. We had friends and family.
You didn't go the usual way, and now Nick will read.
No. I didn't sit in a chair with a pipe and read cerebrally from my book. No, we did the exact opposite. We had a lot of music and fun and food, and I had basically six friends of mine from my past, different parts of my past, to come up and do a roast instead of me. You know, basically cut me up for a good half hour, which was fun for my mom and dad to watch.
and for the whole family, too. Yeah. The book is called Information Bombardment, Rising Above the Digital Onslaught. Are you for it or against it?
Well, I'm actually in between. I'm still trying to figure it out myself.
You're an apostle.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, it's a journey because on the one hand, nobody wants to be disconnected. And on the other hand, we all know that when we are connected, especially with the Blackberries and the iPhones, that it just it consumes us entirely. I mean, we're willing to commit illegal acts. We will check out our email when we're driving on the highway. We know that's illegal. It's the last thing we touch at night before we go to bed when it should be our spouse. Worse yet, it's the first thing we touch in the morning when it should be our spouse or our kids or whatever. So it's all over our lives. And, when we lose it or we misplace it, all of a sudden anxiety, stress, depression, everything kind of shoots through the roof. So imagine what life was like 15 years ago when these things weren't around. Were we more peaceful? Were we more happy? These were supposed to promise mobility and productivity. And they have to a certain extent, but there's a whole bunch of other secondary issues that they've brought to the table as well.
Yeah, I know, because I hear that argument all the time. Well, come on, you got along without them 15 years ago. And my answer to that is that's irrelevant. Because that was then, this is now, we have them now, and they've become a part of our lives.
Yeah, they have become part of our lives, and people notice, children notice. So when you're, for example, at home and you're supposed to be having dinner around the table and playing with your kids and your kid is tugging at your shorts and here you are checking out your BlackBerry and you're telling your kid, chill out, chill out, chill out. I mean, therein lies, I think, the crux of the issue and why I wrote the book is to appreciate that there's got to be this fine line between productivity and work-life balance. And the point of the book is try to figure out what that, what that balance is.
It happens so often that some of the companies, is it TELUS that's using a TV campaign right now that actually parodies that? With the kid trying to play catch with his dad and he's on there and he gets whacked in the head with the ball.
That's right.
And variations on that theme. But it was also the theme of the, when you were nominated as best university professor, mm-hmm. That was the theme of the lecture that you gave.
That's correct.
Basically about that, isn't it? So
yeah.
This has been front of mind for you for some time.
It's been front of mind for a long time, since 1994, believe it or not. This is how long it takes to write a book. I've been doing research in the area of intellectual capital development, knowledge, and information for, since my PhD days. So it's been a long time. But as a young academic, of course, my job, my responsibility is to publish, double-blind peer-reviewed research. And to teach and to conduct service. So for the first, 6 years or so of your career, you're pretty much, toeing the party line here. You can't really have fun. Now that I'm past that hurdle, this book was to have fun.
This is Nick Bontis Unchained?
That's right. That's right. Unchained, untethered. So from concept to imprint last week at the launch was about a year. So that's how long it took exactly. And I've also self-published this book, which is brings a whole new set of complexity to the situation. But I'm glad that I did, because I've learned the process of publishing right now. But it's true when they say it takes a while, because it did take a year from the day that I first opened that blank MS Word document to actually start writing things down to this week.
Do you ever get pangs of guilt? Because I know you love your kids, you love your family, you love your job, you love the technology.
Yeah.
And you can't serve four masters.
Yeah. No, guilt. I mean, I see it every day. I have three kids, Charlie, Dino, and Tia Maria. My middle son, Dino, he knows exactly what to do right now. He will swipe the BlackBerry when I ain't looking, and he will sprint through the house. And he knows that I'm going to be chasing him, because I'm fearful that he's going to dump it in the toilet, right? So, you know, that's...
Well, he did once, didn't he?
He did. That's why I'm saying now that's when I feel guilty, to know that that's, you know, what it resorts to for them to get my attention. The problem with my wife, just to be honest, in the boudoir, is that we're now also both checking out our BlackBerries before we go to bed and checking them out.
She's a very successful business person.
So this is ridiculous, though, yeah. Bill. I mean, you know, whatever happened to the days. I mean, I know prior to the BlackBerries, people would read the paper, let's say, or they would read a book in bed together. But, you know, it seems like, you know, the kids now with their PSPs and their Nintendo DSIs and the parents with their BlackBerries, everybody's got some sort of electronic gadget in their hand.
Are we ever going to go back? I mean, have we gone too far down this road?
So I don't think we're ever going to go back, because the gadgets are getting fancier. Of course, tomorrow's the big launch of the of the RIM playbook, so that's going to bring another gadget into everybody's lives. What I hope, though, is that people never forget one very, very important thing, and this is it. All of them have an off button. And that's what we forget. We forget that, you know what, if you want, if you choose, you can turn it off. It's never going to go away. It's going to be in your pocket, and you can grab it back an hour later.
I tell you what, Jay, let me do the break here, because I wanted to get in something else about want and need, because I know that you touched on that in the lectures and certainly in the book as well. We'll do that right after we do the break. Nick Bontis is with us, the Groot School of Business. The book is called Information Bombardment, Rising Above the Digital Onslaught. Back after we do this. The Bill Kelly Show on CHML and Cable 14. Welcome back. Bill Kelly Show, 900 CHML. You're watching on Cable 14. Dr. Nick Bontis, professor of the DeGroote School of Business at McMaster University. By the way, the website is www.bontis.com. That's B-O-N-T-I-S. And with all things about Nick and some of the fabulous enterprises, the website for the book is informationbombardment.com. That's one word, informationbombardment.com. And you can get some information about this. I was going to ask you about want and need. We'll get into that in a couple of seconds. Talk to me about the journey of going through and publishing your own book, too.
Sure. The first thing is, you've written a whole bunch of research, but you got to basically rewrite it all, because it's got to be put in a different type of language. People who want, you know, a general audience book, they want to read stories. They don't want to hear about T-stat squares and all that kind of stuff. So
it's not a textbook.
It is not a textbook. There's barely any academic citations in it at all. So it's a book for, you know, the common layperson who just wants to understand. This is what I promise you when you read the book, that at the end of this book, you will learn how to work smarter, not harder. And I think that's what we all want. We all want to be able to get to work, accomplish more than we normally do. And what are the tools and tips that can allow you to kind of be able to sift through all your email, for example, collaborate with your colleagues? I address the issue of information bombardment from multiple levels of analysis. Of course, the individual, you know, me and you and our email and the people that we associate with. But I also look at it from a society perspective. For example, I attribute a lot to what happened with 9/11 and Hurricane Katrina. And even right now with the the Japanese tsunami, a lot of that is also related to information bombardment. Too many organizations and government departments getting bombarded with different types of information, and nobody really knowing how to isolate what the critical piece of information is to make the difference. So it's a very generalizable issue.
We're all guilty of that, aren't we?
We are, but here's the problem.
Every email is important. Everything that comes in here is important.
That's
every
right.
Text.
So we know, based on my academic research, that the average office worker in Canada receives 84 emails in a 24-hour period. But of those 84, how many actually drive value for you? How many do you actually need that you can't deal without? And it turns out that it's only about 10%, which means 90% of it all is CC, BCC, CYA, guy from Nigeria wanting his money, all junk. And that junk percentage is going to get worse before it gets better.
But we give them equal weight.
That's right. But we have also learned skills, Bill, over the years that we never had before. For example, one skill we learned is you can read where an email comes from and the subject line and determine in 1.2 seconds if you're going to delete it or not without even opening it. So there's a skill that helps to overcompensate for that bombardment as well.
I've heard different people that use different methodologies for this, too. And they'll look, for instance, and say, if this is directly to me, maybe I'll read it. If I'm part of a group, I'm not even going to open it.
Yeah, well, imagine...
And which may or may not be the correct thing to do, but...
Well, here's the problem, and this is why going on vacation on the weekend and at night is so difficult with people who have Blackberries and iPhones, is because it's the fear of missing that one or two that are critical from your boss or perhaps a client, brand new deal that you're going to miss out on. And that's why you have to take the bad with the good. You got to take all 100 emails to get those two or three that really matter. The other thing too, Bill, that I talk about in the book is the future of email. So we're at a point right now where it's about 15 years in. So if you go back to 95, 96, when we first started with the browsers and email, if you got an email or two in one day, you were King Kong. I mean, you were a superhero.
I remember those days.
You remember those days?
They made right here at this radio station.
They made a movie out of it. I got an email. That's right. They made a movie out of it. Remember the movie? You got mail.
Yeah, that was Tom Hanks.
That's right, Tom Hanks. It was a famous AOL call sign, right? Well, now could you imagine, with 84, you got mails all day, just doesn't work. But I'm predicting that in the next 5 to 10 years, it's not going to be just people that are going to be bombarding us. It is going to be your car. Bill, you got 1/8 tank of gas left. Make sure you go to Petro-Canada before you go home. It's going to be your clothes. Bill, seems like it's a little chilly in this room. Shall I raise you up a couple of degrees? It's going to be your fridge. Bill, make sure you grab some milk before you get home. Imagine all these inanimate objects around us that are going to be IP-enabled with RFID tags and GPS tags. They're also going to be seeking the scarcest resource you possess, Bill, and that scarcest resource is your attention span. And all these inanimate objects are also going to be sending you emails, too.
And those are the ones we should be paying attention to.
Well, because some of them are more important than others, right? Some of them we can ignore, but, let's say, for example, that you have a sensor in your body that monitors your cholesterol level. Right? Because they have these nanotechnology, where they're going to be traveling with your cells. Could you imagine nanotechnology going through the arteries of your heart saying, hey, I just, skipped by your heart 2 seconds ago and I noticed an increase in the walls, the atherosclerosis in your walls. Let's go visit Dr. So-and-so. That's a high priority email.
That's not Fantastic Voyage stuff. Remember that movie from the 1960s?
Yeah.
That's within the realm of possibility.
Yeah, and that's what I talk about in the book. I talk about things that are coming down the pipe. It's not a fiction book. I mean, these are going to be coming down the pipe in the next 5 to 10 years. There's other examples that we see evidence of this all over the place. I mean, we see evidence of Walmart that have, RFID IP-enabled tags on all their supplier pallets, so they know where every single product is throughout their supply chain. We have hotels now that will email you, and you can email the hotel prior to your arrival in the room at night, so you can confirm what temperature you want the room in and how soft or hard you want your mattress in your bed. So we see evidence, and we already know that cars already have more computer power than they did even a few years ago. And a lot of cars have emails. You have, GM with the OnStar product already. If you forget your keys, they can open the door. So it's already in front of us.
Well, and then there's GPS and the way that
That's
basically
right.
tells you how to drive the car and where to drive
That's
it, too.
That's right.
So it's already there.
Yeah.
What about the want and need then?
I mean, sure.
Because let's face it. In some people's minds, they're going to say, well, that's great, Nick, but I need this. I need to stay in touch. I need to stay competitive. I need to check every email. I've got to be on. I've got to take this call.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. Could you, no matter where you are and what you're doing, people think that everything is the most important phone call, the most important email. How do you get your head around the fact that it's not?
So there's two ways that I address that issue in the book. One is with what I call institutionalizing Slack. So what does institutionalizing Slack means? It means a bulk of the emails that you're getting are obviously with the organization that you're affiliated with, you know, where you're at work or CHML or for me at McMaster. One of the problems that a lot of organizations face is they up the ante with expectation. So if your boss sends you an email at 11 o'clock at night and you're not paying attention, then you expect to respond at 11:30. Well, guess what? That means you're going to keep the BlackBerry open until you go to bed. Same thing goes with students. Students email me at 3 in the morning. If I don't email them back at 3:05, then I'm the worst professor on the planet. So what a lot of organizations are doing right now, Bill, is they're institutionalizing a blackout period. So, for example, some government departments in Quebec have said that from 6 to 6, no emails will be sent. From 6 p.m. to 6 a.m. Now, what does that do? It allows you to put your BlackBerry down so you can enjoy dinner with your family, knowing that no important email is going to be sent to you during those hours at night. And what they've done is they've basically institutionalized a policy or basically a ticket. And you have a fine. And, of course, all the proceeds of that fine go to charity. So there's one example.
How long is that going to last, though? Because, I mean, you used to wait an hour and a half for a pizza until somebody says, no, 30 minutes.
Yeah.
And then everybody has to get into the game.
Well, the problem is that it'll last for your organization. So, for example, if you work for a large company and the company institutionalizes a policy, but it's not going to last for your friends or your family. If your wife wants to send you an email to get a hold of you, she's going to send you an email regardless of what time it is. So we're basically talking about not taking all of the email that you have and dealing with it, but a big, big chunk of it and making sure that you actually alleviate stress. Because that's the research that I've done that shows that what we do is we feel a lot of stress when we're not close to our BlackBerry. For example, some business people actually get anxiety the time they're on a plane. So if they're going from, like, let's say Toronto to Vancouver and they're on a plane for 5 hours, their anxiety level shoots through the roof. Not because they're flying, but because they're away from their BlackBerry. They are away from connectivity for 5 hours.
I'm guilty. I guess we all are doing that too. You respond to something at 10:05 at night.
Yeah.
You go, because I don't check my emails constantly.
Yeah.
But when I do, and I respond to them, I sit there and I say, it's been 5 minutes. How come they haven't responded? Why aren't they on there? What's going on with these people?
That's right. Well, that's the expectation thing that I talked about, and that's why I'm setting myself up for failure. Because when students email me and I email them back immediately, guess what? They know now, from now on, if I email Dr. Bontis, I'm going to get a response in 2 seconds. And when I don't, all of a sudden something is wrong. Either they made a mistake or I'm not servicing them as well as I should. But we're not helping the situation any. I talked 2 seconds ago about planes and flying from Toronto to Vancouver. Well, guess what Air Canada is going to be doing now in the next couple of years? They're going to be outfitting all those large jumbo jets with Wi-Fi access for people to stay productive and send emails while they're flying.
But that goes back to the want and need. Do we really need that?
We don't. We could live without it, right? For 5 hours. Isn't it great to actually have a meal and sit down and actually, watch a movie for a couple of hours? In fact, before I came to this interview, Bill, I was in the most peaceful place. You know where that was? At my dentist's office. Because for a whole hour, I had to lie on my back and do nothing but close my eyes and relax.
Let me do the break. You got 2 minutes to do it right now. Dr. Nick Bontis with us. Back after the break, the Bill Kelly Show on CHML and Cable 14. Welcome back. Bill Kelly Show, 900 CHML. You're watching on Cable 14. Dr. Nick Bontis, professor at the DeGroote School of Business at McMaster University and author of the book, Information Bombardment, Rising Above the Digital Onslaught. It's available at, I'll give you a couple of things here. InformationBombardment.com or
Amazon.com.
Amazon.com, okay. Either or, you can get a copy of the book that way. And a lot of reaction to this, too. A lot of folks in the business community that I know that have read some of the early drafts are raving about this book, too. You're getting some pretty good reviews on this.
I'm getting fantastic reviews. I'm very happy that way. And I'm also getting critical reviews, too. So now these are not friends and family, but these are people who actually do book reviews, primarily in the U.S., Bill, because the book is targeted primarily for the U.S. market. But for any listeners who are listening to the show right now, if they want to read Chapter 1, it's available. They can read all of Chapter 1 in its entirety on informationbombardment.com.
All right, and that's the website that will whet your appetite on that. That's well, they could use a little business acumen south of the border these days. Things have not gone well. I just barely touched on the idea of publishing and getting into this because you've done this whole thing by yourself. Mm. What a huge undertaking.
Yeah, it's massive. I mean, I knew that self-publishing a book was going to be a big project. I didn't realize how big. You know, Bill, that I actually have a couple of real jobs, so I'm doing this, you know, part-time in the middle of the night.
And there's this husband and dad thing,
that's
too.
Right, that's right, the kids and the coaching. But I learned a lot. I mean, the publishing industry is turning on its head. You know, you can publish a blog by yourself now, everybody knows. You can have your own radio station by yourself now, everybody knows. But to actually do all the steps from concept to actually getting it out in the stores, you're doing everything. You're typesetting, editing, graphic design, you're designing a website, you're share how, you know, warehousing, distribution, fulfillment, your
artwork.
Yeah, artwork, everything. I mean, every single step I did from beginning to end. And now I'm at the point where Amazon.com is distributing. And of course, I'm just shimmying it through my website. You know, McMaster Bookstore has it. And Ancaster Chapters in the Meadowlands has the book as well. And people are asking, well, when is it going to go to every other bookstore and other websites around the country? And I go, when I have time to get it there. Because people don't realize it's me and my phone and my email that's actually being, you know, that has to make this happen.
All right. Now, when I publish my book, because we all have a book in us, right? And I say, no, I'm going to go the more traditional standpoint. Right. I'm going to go talk to Penguin or McGraw-Hill. Right. I'm just pulling names out of here.
Yeah.
There's a financial concern about that, isn't there?
Well, there is because...
And these are all good people that do
absolutely.
Wonderful work. Don't get me wrong.
But they do all the work for you. So, for example, you know, my book, and I'll just use honest numbers here, my book sells for $28.95, which is the average price of a book. But if I would have gone through a traditional publisher, I would have made about $1 on each of the books that I sold. And people ask, well, why is that? Because that's how much it costs. It actually costs $28 to pay everybody, to pay the editors and the copy editors and the graphic designers, the distributors and the warehousers and the retails and the fulfillment. So when people look at booksellers and authors and they think, how much money are they making depending on the number of books? Well, they're not making a lot. When you self-publish, you keep a little bit more of that money because you're doing it all yourself. But at the end of the day, do you really want to go through all that work as well?
Why does anybody do it then if there's no money into it?
Well, I've written the book for two primary reasons, Bill. One is because I always wanted to. It was in the back of my head and I wanted to get it out. And this was my opportunity. So now I'm happy. I'm satiated. It's done. The second reason is because I am a professional speaker and I really want to build my business in the U.S. marketplace. And to be a Canadian and to go down to Chicago or New York or Las Vegas and speak to a client or a customer, you know, you really need to have a book. So this book, believe it or not, is all written in American English with American spelling and American stories because as we all know, the Americans, you know, when they look at a Canadian, they really think that we are true foreigners and that we couldn't
unless
possibly
you've got a hockey stick
that's
in your
right.
hand.
We couldn't possibly have anything to say as a speaker to an American crowd.
I wish you luck with that. It's because the book itself, the content is what intrigues me about this whole thing because you talk about something that's very timely. I mean, this is not an issue that is unique to the 49th parallel on this side or that side. It's a societal problem and a concern, isn't it?
This is a real issue that's happening right now. It's happening with children whose parents are buying smartphones, who are dealing with Facebook, who are dealing with photos. Well, you know what? It's not.
Are we throwing them into the deep end of the technological pool here?
We are. They do not have the maturity to understand the tension and the implications of privacy. I talk about that in the book. I talk about issues related to photographs, that even if you put a photograph up, and then you take it down, you think it's gone forever? No. Because how do you know that somebody didn't Control-C, Control-V, you know, copy and paste it and send it out? And once you've put that picture up, you've lost control of that photo forever. And these things, this is what I call your digital footprint. It will stay with you forever. And a lot of young McMaster University students are learning this the hard way now when they're trying to apply for jobs. You know, school's out, exams are almost over soon. And the first thing a recruiter is going to do is they're going to hunt you down on Facebook to take a look at your personality.
Well, didn't we see that with the U of T situation?
That's right.
And we've seen that with the way that that the conservatives are basically vetting the people that want to attend their rallies.
Absolutely. We're seeing it right now with the
politics.
I
don't suggest they do it with all of them, but well, I don't know whether they do or they're not. Yeah. But they're going on Facebook.
They are. They're going on Facebook. And in fact, I mean, as an analyst now, I mean, I watch a lot of the politics. You know, I'm looking at Twitter followers, too. I'm looking at what people are saying about different candidates in different ridings. So when you are running as an MP now or MPP for the provincial election, there are so many balls that you have to juggle and keep your hands on. Back in the olden days, somebody said something about you, you probably knew about it. Now people can be saying something something about you all over the web, and it's very, very hard to keep track.
Well, what's the classic story? And I post for pictures when I was in college because, and you know, that was somebody's dirty little secret. I mean, everything's viral now. Everything goes all over the world.
That's
and you
right.
don't know who's watching it. You don't know who's recording it. You don't know who's saving it.
That's right. So one of the tips that I talk about in the book is this idea of alerts. You have to absolutely, the number one, you know, takeaway from my book is you must have a Google alert on your name. Absolutely.
What will that do?
So a Google alert will give you another email, and you can get that email every morning at 9 a.m. just like I do. Every morning at 9 a.m., Google sends me an email, and what they do is they say, Nick, here are all the websites and all the tweets and all the Facebook hits in the previous 24 hours in the whole world that mentioned Nick Bontis. And I'll do a quick skim, make sure that my reputation and my brand is intact. And normally it is. But every now and then I might see something that perhaps I don't like, or perhaps it was construed incorrectly. Perhaps it's on a message board. And that'll afford me the opportunity to set the record straight.
What can you do about it?
Well, if let's say it's on a message board and somebody's criticizing something about a book or something like that, I can comment back as the author and say, you know what, you misinterpreted or you misspoke when you said it and criticized me this way. This is what I really meant. But you're right. Some cases you can't do anything about it. If somebody's written something poor about you, you just hope that it's deep, deep, deep in that massive pile, Bill, and nobody's going to find it.
I know one of the concerns you've had is obviously about confidentiality. And I know that you've talked about this. I mean, you've got three kids, and they're tech savvy, or they're trying to be tech savvy, as just about everybody's kids are these days. But there's a certain, I think some people would suggest immaturity, maybe it's naivety, that, well, it says, well, that's a confidential site. It's confidential. Nobody's going to access that information. And as you say, once it's out there, it's out there.
BS. That's what I always say. Any single time you put anything up, you better understand that anybody else can have access to it. For example, what happens if somebody breaks into a server? You know, we've heard all these stories of all these big, large companies where employees will take their hard drives home and somebody will just leave it on a bus and there goes the hard drive. So you can't assume that anything's confidential or protected. Anything can happen. You know, one of the things my wife and I have learned recently is to stop telling people we're going on vacation. And, you know, simple thing. You go on Facebook right now and read about all the people that tell you where they're at. I'm on vacation, or I'm in Niagara Falls tonight. Well, guess what? You just told 1,000 people that nobody's home. Let's go break into your house. So simple things like that, even myself as a parent, I'm trying to get better at. We have to be very careful what we tell, you know, what we tell the world.
Isn't that part of the reality when you're talking about information bombardment? Yeah. We tend to think, oh, all the people that I want to know that I'm going down to Punta Cana are going to know this, but they don't understand that there's 5,000 other people that can also find that out.
That's right. That's right. So we want to share
photos.
There's
some bad people, and they use this as a tool, too.
They use this as a tool, absolutely. So, you know, this is a rule that my wife and I have now. Absolutely, we want to share our vacation photos with our friends, but we will do it when we come back.
how do you rationalize this stuff, though, Nick? I mean, you know, is the answer here more government control, or just do we have to be more savvy and intelligent about how we use this tool?
Well, I'm not much.
This is like the invention of fire, isn't it?
Yeah, I'm not a big supporter of more government intervention. That's
why I asked.
I think that people just have to be more sophisticated. They just have to learn about the implications. What you don't want is you don't want to learn because you got burnt. You want to learn to be proactive. And one way to do that is to buy a copy of my book, of course, a little plug, because the last four
chapters. That's the best way to do it.
The last four chapters of my book are about 20 specific actionable items that you can take to help deal with this issue of information bombardment. Simple things like, for example, not telling people on Facebook that you're going on vacation, like using rule wizards in your email program. So if you use Outlook, for example, or Gmail, you can use rule wizards to actually parse out certain email from certain people. So for example, whenever I get an email from Bill Kelly, it goes into the priority folder. Whenever I get an email from somebody at McMaster I don't like, it goes into the trash, right? So automatic rule wizards help you deal with that mess.
That and many, many more things included in his book. Listen, before I let you go, you're also going to be involved in the Economic Summit coming
That's
up in
right.
the next couple of weeks, right?
Yeah, May 12th downtown. We still have tickets available for anybody who's interested in building the brand of this city, A, and revitalizing the downtown core. Those are the two big initiatives that we're going to tackle. Last year, we had a phenomenal Economic Summit.
How did you think it went? That was your first time being... I mean, you were the moderator. You were the guy that really kind of kept everything going. How did you feel it went?
I think it went great. I mean, the feedback that we got, obviously people were, top of mind was the whole Pan Am Stadium situation. And obviously we didn't solve it at the summit, and it took another 9 months after the summit. But you know what? We're past it now. We're going to have Ivor 1 part deux coming down the pipe. So let's move into a different initiative, and that initiative is really the downtown core. A lot of passionate people in Hamilton that really want to make sure that downtown Hamilton comes back to the glory days so we can all walk down there with our families, even along the bayfront, and you know, make it a nice walking community.
I know one of the things that that they really want to try to accentuate is some of the success stories. We don't talk a whole lot about how good we are in this city. Is that the Canadian mentality?
No, it's the Hamilton mentality. Yeah. We got to celebrate more. We're going to definitely celebrate some stories in the summit. We want to talk a little bit about the airport, which is a very, very important piece of the puzzle. Obviously, we talk ad nauseum about McMaster's role and Mohawk College role and Redeemer College.
Well, yeah, because it's growing.
Yeah, but we're still going to do that. Innovation Park, McMaster Innovation Park is doing great. We've attracted federal government tenants over there. We're now going to be attracting brand new battery fuel cell powered auto research. So this is kind of the migration that Hamilton is going to take. We're going to move now towards more knowledge-intensive industries, biotech, pharma, those sorts of things. And you know what? We're not alone. Other cities around the world that had steel roots, Pittsburgh being a famous example, have also been forced to make that transition, and now they're thriving, and we're going to do it as well here in Hamilton.
Yeah, we're competing with other cities, and we're winning a lot
That's
of
right.
those battles.
That's right. We're doing well, and we just have to keep on celebrating. The other issue, just to close off, Bill, is the transit. We want to talk about not only having a very strong east-west transit corridor, which we keep on talking about, but we also need to start talking about that north-south. How are we going to connect the airport through Ancaster and down the mountain into the downtown core as well?
Well, we're going to be broadcasting from there once again this year, and we're really looking forward to it too. Let's finish off by talking about the book again, Information Bombardment, Rising Above the Digital Onslaught. The two websites that you can go to get the book, informationbombardment.com or
Amazon.com.
And if you want to get more information about the first chapter, you can read it in its entirety on informationbombardment.com. Dr. Nick Bontis is the author. Nick, good to see you again. Thanks
you
for
too.
This.
Thank
we'll see
you
at the summit.
Me.
We'll do the break. Come back in a couple of seconds. The Bill Kelly Show continues on CHML and Cable 14.